valley, all the clouds are taught to fly. Thus our souls will leave this land most peacefully. Though our minds be filled with questions, in our hearts we'll understand. When the river meets the sea, like a flower that is blossomed in the dry and barren sand, we are born and born again most gracefully. Thus the winds of time will take us with a sure and steady hand. When the river meets the sea, patience, my daughter, and patience, my son, in that sweet and final hour, truth and justice will be done. Like a baby who is sleeping in her loving mother's arms, what a newborn baby dreams is a mystery. But her life will find a purpose, and in time she'll understand. When the river meets the sea, when the river meets the Almighty.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and Jesus Christ the Lord. This is the day the Lord has made, and together we will rejoice and be glad in it. I welcome all of you to Lakewood Presbyterian Church and to this service where we give witness to the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and we celebrate a life lived in love and celebrate the legacy of Janice, Olivia, Unger. I welcome you here. We're glad that you have come, and I invite you, regardless of your church affiliation, please join in the prayers and in the singing and the commendation of Jan's soul to God's safekeeping. We begin with those immortal words of the Apostle Paul, who said this: when we are baptized into Jesus Christ, we are baptized into his death. We are buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of God, we too might have a new life. For this we know, if we have been united with Christ in a death like his, we shall surely be united with him in a resurrection like his. In her baptism, Jan was clothed with Christ and began her earthly journey of life with him. And now she is clothed with his eternal glory. Will you stand with me and together let us worship God? The resurrection and the life. Those who trust in me, even though they die, they will yet live. Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and they know me. The Lord will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them home in his bosom. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord, says the Spirit. They rest from their labors, and their good deeds remain. Jesus also said, My peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid.
Jesus answered, "The first commandment is this,
Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind and your strength. The second one is this. You shall love your neighbor as you love yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these two. Then the scribe said to him, You are right, teacher. You have truly said that God is one, and besides the Lord there is no other. And to love him with all the heart and understanding with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself, this is much more important than all the burnt offerings and sacrifices. When Jesus saw that he had answered so wisely, he said to him, You are not far from the kingdom of God. And after that, no one dared to ask him another question. The gospel of Christ, the good news for us in our time and our circumstances. Now friends, if you would join me in an affirmation of faith taken from Paul's letter to the Romans, and I would ask you to stand with me as we affirm our faith. Let's What do we believe? In life and in death, we belong to God. We trust that all things work together for good, for those who love God and are called for God's good purposes. And we rejoice that nothing in death or in life, nothing present or yet to come, will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the good news we have received, in which we stand, and by which you are preserved as we hold fast. Amen. Our readings from Scripture continue. This next reading again is from the Apostle Paul. I think it describes Jan's life and love superbly. Listen now for God's word. The Apostle said, If I give everything I own to the poor, and even go to the stake to be burned as a martyr, but I do not have love, I have gotten nowhere. So no matter what I say, or what I believe, or what I do, I am bankrupt without love. Love never gives up. Love cares more for others than for itself. Love doesn't want what it doesn't have. Love does not strut. It does not have a slow head. Love doesn't force itself on others. Love isn't always me first. Love doesn't fly off the handle. It doesn't keep score of the sins of others. It doesn't revel when others grovel. Love takes pleasure in the flowering of truth. Love puts up with anything. Trusts God always. It always looks for the best. It never looks back. And it keeps going to the end. Love never dies. Amen. Our scripture this afternoon is taken from the little book of the Hebrew Bible of Ruth. Listen now to these two short verses. But Ruth said, Do not force me to leave you. Do not make me go home. For where you go, I will go. And where you live, I will live. Your people are now my people. Your God is my God. And where you die, I will die, and that is where I will be buried. So help me, God. Not even death will come between us. And when Naomi saw that Ruth had her heart set on going with her, She gave in. And so the two of them traveled on together to Bethlehem. Friends, this is the word of the Lord for us in our time and circumstances. Thanks be to God. Amen. I think it is a joy that we can come into this sacred space, a space in which Jan and Fred spent so many years together. We can come in here not so much to mourn and to be sad, but we can come here and give thanks. To give thanks for a life that was lived long and so very well. And it is because of the way Jan lived her life that we can lift up our hearts and our heads today and rejoice and even laugh a little bit and enjoy one another's company, remembering her and the wonderful legacy that she leaves this world. My sense is that Jan would rather have us do a whole lot more celebrating than mourning today. So let us rejoice and be glad. We are here to celebrate her life and to also proclaim the gospel, the good news that Jesus brought to the world so long ago. Here it is. The good news is that God is for us and not against us. And that all of our alienation, our anxieties, and our burdens can be buried with him who died and was raised to new life. And that is why Christians work and love and live. And yes, we bury our dead in the certain confidence of resurrection life on both sides of the grave. I met Jan, I think it was back in 2005 or 6. I believe she had just been given the medical diagnosis of Parkinson's disease. I did not know that for a few years, and the reason is because Jan did not toot her own horn. And she refused to let Parkinson's disease become her identity. With the help and support of Fred and Chet and Hank and their loved ones, Jan was determined to continue to live life as fully as it can be lived in the joy and the peace and the freedom of God as a child of God. And because she did, because she made that choice, Jan continued to be an inspirational teacher of life and love for all of us. Janice Olivia Unger was a real Southern girl, and I know that because I had one for a mother myself. It really is a thing, right, ladies in the second pew? Jan hailed from Lynette, Alabama. Her mother was a school teacher, so the apple didn't fall far from the tree. Her dad was a manager at the West Point Emerald Company. She and her sister Beverly enjoyed many blessings, the blessings of really good parents, of a happy and good home, of close relationships with cousins and aunts and uncles. Her family were devout Southern Baptists, which means Sunday school was not an option. And therefore, Jan Unger knew her Bible. And she became a Sunday school teacher herself. Jesus' message of God's grace and kindness for the world transformed her heart and the course that her life took, and so she knew that it could do the same for other girls and boys. And so she joined that wonderful rank of God's saints called Sunday school teachers who answered the call to teach the word to children, as Moses put it so long ago. Besides the most honorable vocation of family life and raising her two sons, Jan used her skills and her passions to become a first-grade school teacher after she earned her bachelor's degree from Auburn University. My life, and perhaps your life, bears witness to the fact that really good school teachers change kids' lives. And sometimes they save them from despair or destruction by way of a thousand little kindnesses and words of encouragement and all those seeds of intellectual curiosity that they dropped into our lives. I'm told that Jan willingly taught in classrooms populated by children who were already bearing the heavy burden of poverty and racism. They came from homes where books and fathers and hope were often in short supply. You see, Jan obeyed Christ's command to love God and to love neighbor. Jan was a good steward of God's gifts and graces. She gave her time, her skills, and yes, her money and her energy for others, especially those who lacked privilege. Just about a week ago, Fred handed me, it was at least 7 pages, maybe more, of excerpts from letters and cards from friends and nieces and nephews and neighbors and former students, all of which extolled the qualities and the graces that they had experienced in Jan Unger. These are the descriptions and the words that Fred found to be most prevalent. Kind, gentle, loving, gracious, committed to teaching in the inner city, a good neighbor, a loyal friend, considerate, caring, compassionate, thoughtful, teacher, mother, lovely, a lovely lady. The Apostle Paul had a theory that for God's own good reasons, every person is given a special talent, a skill, or perhaps several of them, to be used in love for the common good. Use your skills, your talents for other people, for the benefit of many. And after reading all those very sincere, very heartfelt, and frankly tear-stained remarks, I came to the conclusion that Jan's special gift was actually hospitality, in that she had that special capacity to make people feel welcome and special, that they too, you know, were God's beloved children, and that they were also endowed with divine worth, chock full of promise and potential. Jan's niece Carrie said it straight up and unalluded. Aunt Jan made you feel like you were the center of the world. I was especially touched by one story from her friend Eddie, who remembered how they were downtown for some special event downtown on Public Square. And Jan's eyes fell on a woman sitting down in the gutter and the curb, crying and upset. And Jan walked up and sat down in the gutter with her and showed her kindness. And then Jan took her home. And there were dozens of other stories of life, of love, of kindness, of laughter, of service. Fred, Hank, and Chet, and all of your loved ones, I know that you will continue to bear witness to this beautiful, lovely lady that was your wife, and your mother, and grandmother. She cared deeply about all of you, and I can tell she left in you some of her greatest qualities. So thank you, I want to say, for your tender care of Jan throughout all of her illness, especially this last year. It became absolutely obvious to me just how powerful and unbreakable the bonds of love and affection that you had together. Jan Unger was a child of God just by virtue of being born a human being. The Christian church takes its clue from Jesus of Nazareth, who taught with his words and also his good deeds and his signs. He taught the world that every person is created in the image and the likeness of God, that each person bears the light of the one eternal God and is welcomed and included in God's unearned, unmerited grace and loving kindness. And that's why we Christians dare call it the good news of the gospel. And like you and me, Jan was an individual, and she was endowed with capacities that she chose to turn loose on the world that God so loves. And her life, like all of our lives, was a reflection of that human reality, that common human reality, that sometimes we really get it right, sometimes we do not, but even when we fall short of our potential or capacity, God does not turn away from us. The gospel is all about this unconditional love thing. It is the good news, and it is what we celebrate today as we reflect on Jan's life of love. It is enough for me to extol the qualities, the good things of an individual. It is also my job to tell you the good news of Jesus' promise. He who reminded us that we are not alone, that our lives belong to God, who claims us as children, who loves us without condition, and who offers us care and companionship and strength and hope we need it most. And Jesus said that when our mortal lives come to their inevitable end, he promised that a room would be prepared for us, and that upon our departure from this world, we would be welcomed into a new home in God's heaven. Now, I am not one of those preachers who can tell you all the details of who's going to be there and who won't, although I'm pretty sure Jan will be there. But I can tell you I believe that truth with all of my heart. And that is why I rejoice today with all of you. And so, trusting in the promises of God, let us not forget this soul who came to us, Janice Olivia. She who journeyed with us and gave the people she loved the most her very best qualities, who shared her values, who loved the world as God loves it. Let us continue to give thanks for Jan's life, for her love, her labor, and for that certain promise that we will be gathered again with the very ones that we have loved and lost, but it will be on a different shore and in much more glorious light.
Thank you. On behalf of my father, Fred, and my brother, Chet, his wife, Maria, and my mother's two grandchildren, Axel and Miles, as well as on behalf of representatives from both sides of the family, nieces, Janice, Kari, Jan, and Beth, we're just so grateful to be with all of you here today to celebrate my mom. And I've been feeling mostly celebratory. Of course, there's grief for all of us. There's grief in this moment when we lose a loved one. But one of the things that has given me the most peace in this journey of this new relationship with my mother, this relationship that is partially physical for me and non-physical for her, and us finding that space together, has been that her departure from this world was incredibly peaceful, and it seemed to be absolutely of her choosing, and her peace with that. And I would really like to take this time to publicly, for all of us, to honor the incredible love, the incredible support, and the unwavering dedication that my father showed my mother during the last 9 months of her life. For the last, you know, they're 55 years together, of course. But I don't know if there is a greater example of love, of dedication, of commitment, and steadfastness to be there for someone that you love. And I know that my brother, Maria, boys, all of our sisters, all of my mother's sisters, are just so grateful to my father, as to other family members who are not here with us, and all of you who know my father and my mother. And I truly know very deeply that that steadfastness, as you mentioned, that support created an experience for her that was extremely intimate with her. In addition, there are three other remarkable human beings who would like to thank: Aggie McLaughlin, Annie Green, and Keisha Moore. These three women were part of this journey of creating a space for my mother during, as we all know, an incredible time of a tumultuous time in the world when anything was more difficult, more challenging than it might have been. And these three women showed such love, such dedication, and such extraordinary compassion and understanding, and stay beyond their scheduled time if it was necessary. And I don't know if my father, my brother, the rest of our family, I don't know what we would have done without that support. And so we're so immensely grateful to each one of them. And I'd also like to share something that was shared with me at another service for a beloved friend and someone who loved my mother, and my brother loved very much as well. But as I've been sitting with this, and as I've been spending time with the lessons that my mother taught, and I think one of the greatest final lessons that my mother taught me was a lesson about death and about leaving this world. And I committed to continue learning that lesson as I continue to live my life, as I continue to celebrate life with all of you here today, celebrating my mother and her vitality and passion and her love for all of you, and her love for so many who are with us today too. Death is nothing at all. I have only slipped into the next room. I am on, and you are here. Whatever we were to each other, that we are still. Call me by my old familiar name. Speak to me in the easy way which you always have used. Put no difference in your time. Where the forced air of sin and your sorrow. Laugh as we have always laughed at the little jokes that we share together. Pray, smile, think of me, pray for me. Let my name be ever the household word that it always uses. Let it be spoken without effect, without the trace of a shadow on it. Life means all that it ever meant. It is the same as it ever was. There is unbroken continuity. Why should I be out of mind? Because I'm not a son.
Let us pray. God of grace, we give you thanks today that you have given us a new and living hope in the message of Jesus Christ. Help us to know that because he lives, we too shall live, and that nothing in death or in life, nothing past, present, or yet to come, will be able to separate us from your love and grace. Lord, before you, generations of people rise up and they pass away. And we do praise you for all of your servants who, having lived this life in faith, now live eternally with you. Especially today, we thank you for your servant Janice, whose baptism is now complete in death. Lord, we praise you for the gift of her life and for everything in her that was good and lovely and kind and faithful and true. We give you thanks for the grace that you placed in her, that helped her to love her family and her friends, her community, her students, and to love you above all else. We thank you that for Jan, death has passed and all pain has ended, and that she has now entered the joy that you have prepared for us. We give you thanks for Jesus' promise that within your heavenly realm there are many rooms. So give us faith to see beyond this time and space. Lift sorrow and give us good hope as we continue to walk upon these our earthly journeys, always looking forward to a glad reunion in the life that is yet to come. Gracious God, receive your servant. May she rest in peace and rise in glory. And now we pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Holy Spirit, rest and abide with you this day and always.